Welcome to the Nobody Guide to Life, where we provide tips and tools for personal growth, personal development, and your spiritual journey that you can use right now in your everyday life. I'm J.A. Plosker. You can always find out more at thenobodyguidetolife.com, or you can check us out at Twitter and Facebook at Nobody's View, or join the Facebook group Simple Spirituality. Thank you for joining us. Halloween comes around each year on October 31st, and this year, I dug a little into the history of Halloween, specifically at history.com, and I found some interesting information, some of which you probably already know and some you probably don't. I know I didn't know a lot of this. So the ancient origins of these festivals we observe through the year, it's always interesting to research them. So it's worth taking a look when holidays like this come around. So a little disclaimer, of course, histories can differ. So do your own research if you're inclined to go down that path. So some believe Halloween originated as part of the Celtic festival of Samhain or summer's end. So it was a time when folks lit bonfires and put on costumes to keep ghosts away. A time of, you know, harvesting, gathering before the darkness of winter, bringing your flocks back. Around this time, it was thought that the departed could come back and visit the world of the living. So eventually, the Catholic time of All Saints Day on November 1st merged with some of these traditions of Samhain, and we now have a time called All Hallows Eve and now Halloween. So there's a lot more to the story, a lot more. So I'll put the link in the show notes for you so you can read on, or you can just type Halloween history into your search bar and see what comes up. But I want to talk more about this time of year in the modern era and what it can tell us about ourselves on this journey of personal and spiritual growth. So years ago, I remember getting all dressed up as some character that honestly I can't remember now. And I went to a friend's house for trick or treat. And as we went around his neighborhood, we were terrified. You know, the dark brings up so many feelings in us, you know, and my friend and I had already scared ourselves pretty good in his living room with ghost stories before we headed out. So that really wasn't a great start. But when we were out there on the street, when we were out there trick or treating, I remember that the streets were deserted in his neighborhood for some reason. I guess everybody went somewhere else for trick or treat, and every rustling noise, every shadow, everything scared us. I was never so relieved to get back home as I was that night. So childhood memories aside, these days, the news is so full of frightening things. It almost seems redundant to scare ourselves again at the end of October. But I have to say, I did like the candy eating part of Halloween. I remember trading candy with my friends. I'd take the Twix bars and the peanut butter cups, and I'd give away the Snickers bars and sweet tarts. And now I know what you're thinking, why keep peanut butter cups, but give away the bars with whole peanuts in them? And I'm here to tell you, there's definitely a difference. So let's just leave it at that. And as I got older, I left trick-or-treating behind and went to Halloween parties. And instead of seeing a bunch of scared kids, I saw that wearing masks and costumes actually made people bolder. It made them more willing to join the crowd or ask for a date or do things they wouldn't normally do. And that's the power of masks as we age, right? I mean, we're all pretty familiar with that. In episode 30, I talked to Debbie and Dr. Rob Maldonado about Jungian coaching. And as many of you probably know, this idea of masks is something that has come down through history as a powerful idea of hiding, of projecting a face to the world that may not always be accurate or complete. And according to psychologist Carl Jung, we all have this mask or persona, which is a part of our personality that we project to the world. And we adopt the mask because we want to adapt socially, or we want the convenience of being perceived in a certain way out there in the world. So in other words, the mask is how our ego interacts socially. So maybe we want to be seen as the social rebel or the heroic doctor that we see on TV all the time. Perhaps we're the lawyer fighting day in and day out for justice. Or think of an actor who maybe can't put his or her status aside, who always has to be on in the public eye. Their fame is always on display. They can't separate it from themselves. If you don't think masks have power, then ask yourself why people are so intrigued with shows that give us a behind-the-scenes look at an actor's life away from the spotlight. When we come to find out that famous people are really, in so many ways, just like you and me, it can be startling, maybe even a little unsettling. I know stories of people who have met famous actors in person and have told me that those actors were not very nice to them in public. And some actors have that reputation. And the thing is, we build people up and create expectations of people based on their masks. And when those masks get ripped away, well, it's sometimes hard to integrate that new perception. Sometimes we don't know how to interact with people once they show their authentic self, their true colors. You know, I know people who have stopped watching certain shows or going to movies that feature a certain actor because of those interactions. So this whole mask thing, you know, that can work for us for a little while. But the problem comes in when we associate so strongly with the masks we wear, the roles we play, that we neglect the other sides of ourselves. Or worse, we deny our true nature because we want to continue to conform to a societal role or a social standard. We spend so much time trying to polish one image that we get knocked out of balance and we forget there are other sides to who we are. So a workaholic man or woman may neglect their more caring parenting side, or a tough independent person may not really realize there's a side of them that really needs help or guidance from others. And not only can we neglect these other sides of ourselves, but we can even push those parts we don't like into what's called the shadow, what Jung called the shadow. Those parts of our personality that maybe didn't go over so well out there in the world, they can become part of this hidden place, this unconscious place where we hope no one will ever see them. And here's the thing about that shadow. Instead of looking at it and examining it in ourselves, Jung believed that we project these perceived distasteful qualities onto others, and instead of working on that trait in ourselves. So you do that, right? I mean, I know I do. On a calm day, you know, you don't have a lot going on. Maybe you're not in a hurry. So you're driving along and you judge every fast driver on the freeway who blows by you as a careless, reckless person. But all you need to do is maybe reflect on a moment when you've been late for an important meeting. And chances are you'll find that same reckless driver in yourself, zipping along in the fast lane. See, the traits we find so distasteful in others are often the very things we need to work on in ourselves. So as Halloween, this season of masks, approaches, what's the face that you project to the world? What is it you want people to see and believe? You know, we like to think that masks and dressing up are only for this time of year, but they're not. Every morning when you get up, you get ready to face the day, you know, we all put on our masks. Maybe we think, I need to be the stable parent, or I want to be the person at work who gets along with everyone. We brush our teeth, comb our hair, put on clothes, and then don that mask that we want the world to see. But what about those other parts of our personality behind the mask? You know, even the most stable parent gets knocked off kilter when their kid has a tantrum at the store. Do you forgive yourself when you, well, I guess, lose face in public? Or do you feel ashamed and want to hide that part of you that gets embarrassed? So turning instead to anger and yelling at your kids to project an air of detached control to people watching you. This doesn't get to me. I can handle this. Even the most mild-mannered person at work probably has fantasies of telling a difficult client off, you know? Do you give yourself space to acknowledge your frustrations and decompress? Or do you hide that part of your work life and carry around the 5,000-pound weight of people-pleasing? One of the more difficult parts of this road of personal and spiritual growth is coming face-to-face with parts of ourselves and the world that we don't really like. And often the practices we take on this journey regularly, you know, rip off our masks and light up our shadows. And that's not always fun. I mean, you know that. So for example, if we take on a practice of meditation, we're often faced with the unpleasant experience of having a host of difficult images paraded in front of us while we're trying to focus on our breath. We realize in a meditation session that maybe we're still hung up on events from the past, or we have feelings of guilt and anxiety well up within us, or we realize we're not the calm saints with stable, quiet minds that we believe we are or we want to be. And it's tempting to get up and run from the practice and run from those images. Or here's one that you probably are familiar with. We get caught up in the persona of, quote, spiritual person, unquote. We take on the burden of this path, believing that since we're now on this road of spirituality or personal growth, we have to walk through the world like gurus, not letting anything or anyone bother us. And when someone or something does get under our spiritual skin, it can seem like we failed on our quest. Or how about this one? When people say things like, hey, aren't you the spiritual one? Nothing should bother you. Those comments can hurt because they invalidate our human side and add to the shame we can feel when we let something bother us on this difficult path of personal and spiritual growth. See, here's the thing. No matter how hard we try, we're still going to be who we are. No matter how detailed the costume, how elaborate the mask, or how much we try to hide, we're going to feel how we feel and do what we do. No matter how spiritual we want to be, we're still going to run into that person who makes us want to think bad thoughts. We're still going to have to deal with difficult clients or that person we know who seems to be having a bad day every day, and they want us to know about it every single time we interact with them. No matter how hard we try to be somewhere else, we're going to be here now. No matter how tightly we close our eyes, we're still going to be ourselves in the darkness behind our eyelids. See, this path we're on, you and me, it's not about creating elaborate masks. It's not about decorating our bodies with costumes or hiding in the dark. It's about ripping off the coverings and shining light in the shadows to see who we really are. It's about trying as best we can to see the difficult characters in our lives as projections of ourselves, guiding us to a better realization of the role we play as the difficult characters in someone else's drama. And it's about getting past that drama again and again and again. Here's something you can try. The next time you see something you perceive as distasteful in another person, look at them, really look at them. And then look beneath the surface. See if you can't peel the mask away from them just a little to see who they are underneath. Then, if you're brave, take it a step further. Look for a place in your life where that distasteful trait resides in you. Then challenge yourself to identify and overcome it in a situation. So if you have a person in your life that talks too much and it bothers you, see if you can't just find a place in your day where you talk a little too much. Identify it, work to overcome it by being more gracious in conversation or resolving to be quieter in your daily chats. Doesn't mean you can't participate, just means you're going to participate consciously. This is a small and subtle way of practicing every day, of exploring the shadow, of getting behind the mask. See, Halloween comes once a year. It's a celebration of masks and shadows. It's a time to make light of the dark. It's a time when we ask for candy that can, for a very brief time, sweeten the bitterness of life. But personal and spiritual growth, that's every day. And there's nothing to do about the masks and shadows except to face them head on. I suppose we could continue to hide, but where's the adventure in that? Where's the fun in that? But that means being brave and exploring the dark with the face we have. That brings us to the end of this episode of The Nobody Guide to Life. You can always find out more at thenobodyguidetolife.com, or you can reach out to us on Twitter and Facebook at Nobody's View, or join the Facebook community, Simple Spirituality. If you like what you hear on this podcast, please consider a review or a subscription. We'd really appreciate it. Keep practicing and have a good week.